welcome to Writers on Writing. I am your host, Dr. Brenda Greene, and we are coming to you from the studio of Megar Evers College over the airways of WMYE 91.5 FM. Writers on Writing comes to you every Sunday and gives you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers from the African diaspora talk about their work, their lives, and their craft. And I'm very, very pleased to have on the telephone with me this evening, professor, writer, scholar, Jeffrey Renard Allen. Welcome, Jeffrey.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here with you. Thank you so much.
Well, I'm really, really pleased to have an opportunity to talk to you and to share you with our, or to have our audience hear about you and hear about the wonderful work and this phenomenal book that you've written. And I just want to share with the audience more information about you. Jeffrey Renard Allen is the author of the novel Rails Under My Back, the story collection Holding Pattern, and two collections of poetry. He was born and raised in Chicago and now lives in New York City, where he teaches at Queens College and in the writing program at the New School. He has won a number of awards. Rails Under My Back won the Chicago Tribune's Heartline Prize for Fiction. His other awards include a Whiting Writers Award, the Ernest J. Gaines Award for Literary Excellence, and the Charles Angoff Award for Fiction from the Literary Review. And your essays and reviews and poetry have appeared in numerous publications. So, you are definitely a literary star.
Well, maybe some would say that, you know.
Yes, and your most recent book, Song of the Shank, has received excellent reviews. Mitchell Jackson, who's a professor here at Megar Evers College, says that Song of the Shank brilliantly portrays the story of Blind Tom while providing keen insight into the history of Reconstruction. But at its heart, it also reminds us, denizens of never will be post-racial America, of one simple but everlasting essential truth: them chains is hard on a man, hard. And so this novel is so layered and tells so many stories. And as Mitchell says, it's also brings up the history of Reconstruction while telling the story of Blind Tom. So I'd like you to begin, if you can tell us a little bit about Blind Tom. Who is Blind Tom?
Well, Blind Tom was an important historical figure in terms of American music, or in terms of international music. I think that's probably the thing I should start by saying, because his importance has been overlooked in recent decades since he died in 1908. But he was born a slave in Georgia in 1849, and by the accounts about him, he began to play piano essentially around the age of two. The slave owner and his wife had a piano in the home, and the wife was a piano teacher. So the story goes that at age two, he crawled up to the piano and began playing the composition that she had just been playing. And so within a few years, he was actually giving concert recitals by age six or so. And soon after that, he was under the care of a professional manager who took him on tour. And he primarily had a classical repertoire with along with some compositions that he wrote, which were imitations of man-made and natural phenomena such as rainwater and sewing machines. And he also had a very kind of radical stage performance for the time. In fact, he was billed as the Blind Tom Exhibition because he would do these incredible feats of memory, where he would invite members of the audience to come up on stage and play original compositions, which he would play back. And the time. He would do things such as play three songs at once in different keys and all kinds of, you know, really unusual things. So he was extremely successful in terms of his stage performances, in terms of drawing audiences. And you know, by the time he was 10 years old, he had played at the White House under James Buchanan, when James Buchanan was president. So he, in fact, was the first African-American to play at the White House to ever do that. And then he went on tour all around the United States, all across the United Kingdom, all across Europe, gave, you know, many concert recitals, and had a career that lasted for about 30 years or so or more, you know, from the mid-1850s until the late 1880s. And then he pretty much retired from stage and came back briefly in the early years of the 20th century during the vaudeville era. And within a couple of years of that, he suffered a stroke, and he died in June of 1908, which is kind of interesting to remember, is that Jack Johnson would later win the World Heavyweight Boxing Championship that year in December. And in some ways, the two men's lives offer a really interesting contrast in that, by appearances at least, Blind Tom seemed to be completely subservient, you know, under the, you know, the rule and thumb of his manager and slave owners and so on. You know, so much so that he gave concerts that benefited the Confederate cause. You know, he raised money for the Confederate cause.
It seems like we're losing you a little bit. Are you?
Oh, sorry. Can you still hear me?
Yes, that's better.
Okay. So he gave these concerts for the Confederate cause. He wrote songs that celebrated Confederate victories. So, you know, on the surface at least, he seemed to have been a completely kind of brainwashed slave who, you know, kowtowed to the wishes of his owner and manager. And so that's pretty much who he was. And I think it's also important just to close by saying that he was probably the most successful pianist of the 19th century. But, you know, within a few years of his leaving the stage, really, within after the 1880s, I mean, within a few years, he had pretty much disappeared from public. And so that's where, you know, where it stands today still. Yes.
Right. So it's very interesting that you came across this story, or you decided to write this story. And as you said, it's interesting to see the contrast, or the two figures, Jack Johnson and him, Blind Tom, positioned at the point in time at which they are. What was the motivation for you telling this story? Because this is not the first biography other people have written. Why did you tell it and decide to make it historical fiction?
I wouldn't necessarily object to the term historical, but you know, then again, I will object to the historical fiction. I mean, I don't see
historical
it.
Narrative, because it is. Yeah. I mean, it's really hard to. Sometimes you do forget where you are in this story, at what time period, but you're reminded. You know, you have the island of Manhattan, then you have the relationships with the servant and master. You're kind of going back and forth in time. There are a lot of time shifts here.
Right. Yeah, I think what I meant by the fact that it's not a historical novel, I only mean that I see it more as a kind of riff on history, maybe in a most musical sense as possible, and that I sort of took some of the most interesting facts of Blind Tom's life and I exaggerated them and pushed them into the realm of fiction. So, you know, this is a way of saying that I never really set out to do like a dramatized biography. Well, that's not completely true, because in the earliest drafts of the novel, I thought what I would do, in fact, would be to do a dramatized kind of biography, because he had had such a fascinating life, you know. And but there had already been one person, a scholar named Geneva Southall, who had spent her professional career researching Blind Tom's life and writing a biography of him. So there was already that, and I didn't see any need for me to write a biography. But so what I really became interested in was how I could use his story to speak to certain issues of our own day, and certain issues of his time, and certain issues in the history of our country that don't really get the kind of representation.
And what would those issues? Give us some examples of that.
Well, I do think the primary thing here really is the whole question of Reconstruction, because my novel is set from the present action, at least covers 3 years. It's set between 1866 and 1869, which are the first years of Reconstruction. And in a way, the plot of the novel parallels this whole question of Reconstruction because, among other things, one of the characters in the novel hopes to bring Blind Tom back to the stage. The idea in the novel, and this is completely made up on my behalf, but the idea in the novel is that during the Civil War draft riots of 1863, Blind Tom was given a concert, was attacked, and all of the black people in Manhattan were driven out of Manhattan onto this island called Edgemere, which, there's no Edgemere. And I never call the city Manhattan, actually. I just call it the city. But,
and we have Central Park, too. That seems
referenced.
It
kind of goes between, I feel like a riff on fact and a riff on history. So there are aspects of the city which are New York, and then there are other aspects of the city which aren't New York necessarily. So once again, I sort of took some of those basic facts and exaggerated them. But the basic idea is when the novel opens that Blind Tom is hiding in Manhattan, essentially. He's the last black person left in the city. And at some point, a black entrepreneur shows up and says, well, I'm here to take Tom back to his mother. And his true goal really is to try to bring Tom back to stage, back to the stage, because he hasn't performed in a few years. And, he's not doing it for altruistic reasons, but he's doing it because he wants to resume Tom's career and make money off of him like everyone else does. So that's what I mean. So it's in that sense, he's trying to reconstruct, Tom's image to bring him back to who he was before the draft riots and the war. And then, that's meant in part to be a metaphor for the whole project of Reconstruction in America, which, of course, is a failure. Which was a failure. And so what I mean is one of the things that attracted me to this story was the fact that there were these possibilities to address Reconstruction. And the idea for that actually came out of part of his biography. One particular interesting fact about his biography, which is that there was indeed a black entrepreneur from Cincinnati who entered into a business arrangement with Tom's owner or former owner, and the owner reneged on the agreement. And so this businessman sued the owner in a Cincinnati court to try to obtain custody of Tom. And the court ruled in the owner's favor, the former slave master's favor, because they decided that Blind Tom was a mental incompetent, and for that reason, his former slave master would be the best person to take care of him, I think that in and of itself it speaks to kind of the failures of Reconstruction, even before Reconstruction was, on its way. And I think we're still in that whole phase of the question of Reconstruction, because it was never resolved,
Right. It also speaks to your Reconstruction. Reconstruction. No, I appreciate that. And the whole nature of racism and institutionalized and race relations. And you have a situation where someone can say a young man has such a genius, who's really a genius in terms of music, can be an idiot. So how do you reconcile that?
Well, I think that was another issue that drew me to the book, because I was primarily interested in this question of creativity. What exactly is creativity, and where does art come from? That was one of the pressing issues too. And in terms of Tom's life, there is a lot of controversy around that particular matter, because on the one hand, if you look at who writes about Tom for the most part today, you know, you'll find that who writes about him are medical professionals. And, you know, so in fact, I discovered Tom's story through Oliver Sacks's book, An Anthropologist on Mars. And as you know, Oliver Sacks is a trained neurologist and also a writer. So Oliver Sacks presents one view of Tom, which is the one that's usually accepted, most widely accepted one, which is that he was an autistic savant. And for that reason, therefore, he had no true creativity. You know, he only played by imitation, by, you know, remote, as it were. And on the other hand, there's the idea that, as his biographer, Geneva Saldal, presented the notion, the idea that Blind Tom was, as you say, a musical genius. You know, this kid was simply a genius. But, you know, the realities of America at the time is that America cannot accept the fact of, you know, a black genius. I mean, America cannot accept the fact of black people's intelligence. So to accept America in the 1860s and so on, to accept the notion of black genius is, you know, is something impossible. So those are kind of the two extremes. And I was really interested in this whole question of, you know, was it creativity or was this genius? And, you know, and of course, if Tom were a genius, you know, the fact that he has been written out of musical history becomes an even tremendous, you know, tremendous type of erasure, you know, of great magnitude. You know?
Yes, though you are bringing up some very, very poignant points. And one of the ways you do this and you get at all of these perspectives is the use of through the use of multiple narrators. Can you talk about that? You have different people telling his story.
Yes, I do. So I think it, when I first began writing the novel, my plan was to have these multiple narrators who would tell different aspects of Tom's life and perceive him differently, and, you know, each person would take something unique from this character. And then I thought I would have a late section in the novel, perhaps even the final section of the novel, that I would have this section in Tom's voice where he would finally sort of speak and reveal himself to the world amidst all of the speculation that had gone on before in the early pages of the book. And I think ultimately what I decided is that, you know, and when I read about Blind Tom, you know, even though all of the facts that were available were there on the page, I never got a clear sense of exactly what made this guy tick, you know, like, you know, who exactly was he? Was he a savant? Was he something else?
Right.
You know, was he just a crazy musician? You know, just musicians tend to be that way, you know, just eccentric and strange. He didn't give really many statements that are on the public record. So one of the things that attracted me to him was the fact that he was this mysterious character. And I thought one of the ways to maintain that mystery and also to raise suspense in the reader's mind, I thought one of the best ways to do that would be to have, you know, different characters tell Tom's story, to perceive him through the eyes of these other people. And for the most part, there are six major characters in the novel. And of those six, let's see, I think five are based on actual people. And the other character is completely my invention. So what's also interesting, too, in terms of the historical record, like these six people were on record as having, you know, certain positions politically or whatever in terms of their relationships with Blind Tom. But once again, I couldn't say that I really knew them intimately in the way that you would like to know people. So because they were kind of blank spaces as well, I was able to use my novelistic imagination to enter their minds and to have them perceive Tom. And one of the things that unites all of the perspectives is the fact that every character in the novel responds in a different way to Tom's music, and also every character in the novel, in a sense, responds in a different way to Tom. I mean, that is to say that everybody wants something from him for certain reasons, and me that desire, that longing to use Tom was more important than having us enter Tom's mind directly.
Right, which is why, so Tom ends up being, Blind Tom ends up continuing to be mysterious, and even as the writer of the novel, you never can really get inside of his skin. You have to enter it through other people.
Right. What I tried to do with that really is, you see Tom in you see him in scenes, and you hear him say things, and I really wanted to leave it up to the reader to interpret, what exactly is going on with this guy when he makes some strange statement. Because most of the things he says are cryptic. His behavior is often, mysterious and startling. But also that was part of my characterization of Tom, too, because I didn't want him to simply be an autistic character, and for that reason, to lack any kind of human complexity in terms of his desires and wants. So one of the things that happens in the novel is that even though we may be unclear about what exactly Tom may mean at a given time or what he may want, one of the things we are always certain about with him is that he is an extremely forceful character, and through his force, he has a type of agency, which may have been the only thing he could have had control over in his own life in actuality, which is to say that the only thing he ever had control over really was his music, the fact that he could play or not play, so I wanted to give Tom, a tremendous amount of agency in the book, even if he is mysterious and even if he is exploited,
Right. So what was your process going in, your process for writing this book? Because it took you a number of years. What kind of research did you engage in to write this book?
Yes, the research, I should start by saying that, I first really heard about Blind Tom, I first became interested in Blind Tom around 1998, when I think back to it now, I realize I had actually read about him in some other books earlier in my life, but at that time, he had no reason to really be a compelling force for me. I wasn't drawn to his story in those early years. But so I became interested in him in 1998, and I did some kind of modest research about him, but nothing serious. But then in 2001... In the fall of 2001, I was a scholar at the Center for Scholars and Writers at the New York Public Library, and that's when I began to do it.
Your voice is going.
Oh, sorry. Can you hear me?
Yes, it's much better.
Okay. So in 2001, I was a fellow at the Center for Scholars and Writers at the New York Public Library, and that's when I began to research Tom's life in earnest and tried to dig up everything I could find out about him. So that process lasted for, for 2 or 3 years, because initially I was drawn to this story with the impression that I would use it as part of a larger project, a kind of novelistic project, a larger historical project that had different storylines set in different time periods and that kind of thing. And then it took me a couple of years to realize that I wanted to focus solely on Blind Tom. So, that process from 1998 to, let's say, 2003 was how that went. And, it took a few years to figure out exactly what I was trying to do with the research that I had. And then in 2003, when I first began to do a draft of the novel, I settled on the idea that I would, in fact, do his entire life. I would go from 1849 until 1908. So that ended up entailing a lot of research, because I began to read everything I could about that particular period in American history. So quite literally, I was reading, I read, I don't even know how much I read, but I spent at least a good year, an entire year, just reading everything I could about that particular period. I was also reading about things that I felt I needed to know more about. I was raised on soul music.
Okay, I don't know why you're fading a little bit.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes, we're going to have to bring it to a close.
Okay,
so you have done a phenomenal task in writing this story, this very, very layered story. And I'd like to close by quoting what Ishmael Reed said of Song of the Shank and his early acclaim. He said, talent and brilliance are not enough. Writing a novel like this is the equivalent of building a three-story building. Single-handedly, Jeffrey Renard Allen scores highly with this novel about the Michael Jackson of the 19th century, the savant Blind Tom. So this is a book I learned so much. And as I said, it's not the kind of book I could just sit down and go through, but it kept me going. I had to sit down, think, and then go back to it. And it's a fascinating story, and one it made me want to do more research about Blind Tom. So I really thank you for writing Song of the Shank.
Thank you for having me. Okay. It's been a great honor.
You're welcome. And I want to encourage our listeners to go out and purchase Song of the Shank, a novel by Jeffrey Renard Allen. It is a novel of history. It's a novel of genius. It's the kind of book you should have in your library. And I want to thank my engineer, Fritz Richardson, and want to remind you that the writer is always reading, the reader is always writing. Keep reading and writing. Empower yourselves as readers and writers. And once again, thank you, Jeffrey Renard Allen, for giving us this work.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Come back next week.
So, Brenda, should I go back and finish that statement?
Next song was inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers, and we call this song I've Known Rivers.